I am standing here on 400 acres of dry ground at the eastern edge of the Imperial Valley. It is hot, it is dry, and very soon there's going to be a solar farm here. The Imperial Valley of California grows the largest share of the nation's winter vegetables, including broccoli, carrots, and cauliflower. And they do that by using more than half of California's total intake from the Colorado. That is 5 times as much water as the entire city of Los Angeles.
Water from the Colorado is now made to flow from the dam to the Imperial Valley, where it turns a once dry land into a farming paradise.
With worsening drought and climate change, that water supply is shrinking. Putting more solar projects on farm ground could help save water, but not everyone is happy about it.
I believe that the solar people came in and they sold us a bill of goods. You lost production, you lost tax, you lost jobs, you lost all these things. And what did we get for it? Nothing.
To take beautiful farm ground out of production that feeds the nation is ridiculous to me.
Over the last decade, the Imperial Valley has seen huge growth in solar farms. This could help California solve some of its hardest water and energy challenges. But what would more solar mean for the people who live there?
The California grid, and actually the grid in general, really needs a diverse portfolio of sources of energy.
We're understanding how finite the Colorado River is, and it's even at a critical stage now.
So how is this farming community in the middle of the desert dealing with a changing climate and the energy transition? I went there to find out. We're driving here right alongside some farm fields down in the Imperial Valley. This is in the very far southeastern corner of California, so like 3.5, 4-hour drive out of Los Angeles. This is one of the hottest and driest parts of the state, but the really amazing thing is they've taken lots and lots of Colorado River water and just, they've made the desert bloom. They've got loads of agriculture here, a lot of the winter vegetables that are eaten all over the United States. I've reported a lot of stories out of Imperial County, and Californians should really know about this place. Our climate future, our energy and water challenges as a state, a whole lot of that is going to be determined right here. This right here is the beginning of the All-American Canal. So this is where we've got the Colorado River flowing here through Imperial Dam. They turn on these head gates, which are built in the 1930s, still in use. And the water comes through here, and then it goes right along the US-Mexico border and irrigates hundreds of thousands of acres of farm fields in the desert in the Imperial Valley. It makes the place bloom. It's pretty remarkable. Jack Vesey is a local farmer who's lost some of his land to solar. What generation are you?
Fourth generation.
Yeah. Wow. Okay, so you've got 100 years of family history here, just about.
Yeah.
My family was on this ground for 50 plus years and was told by the landowner that he decided to lease it and turn it into solar ground. I just think it's sad to look out here and think about all the people that worked hard to produce a crop for the United States, feed the nation, and now it's all gone.
This is Jack's friend Danny Robinson, another farmer. He's also lost land to solar.
It's not easy to find farm ground because most of the guys farming don't let go of what they have. I have flown over it, not even thinking about it. I was coming from Houston going to San Diego, and I just happened to look down and I saw this and how different it looks from the air.
What do you think when you see that?
Well, for me, lost opportunity.
Yeah.
For my landlords, a good deal.
Yeah, I can see that. Some Imperial Valley residents have embraced solar power. Ray Castillo is one of them. He's a county supervisor and he's one of the industry's biggest supporters.
Well, these panels, if you'll notice, they have, they're motorized. So they track the sun.
That's amazing that they can do that.
I think the future for solar looks bright. And it's not just about creating more revenue for the county, but it's also creating more jobs.
You know, I've been talking to some people, some farmers, some landowners who feel like what they know is being taken away from them, right? They feel like first the cities came in and took our water, now they're coming in and they're gonna, you know, put solar up and take away our farmland, and you give them an inch, they're gonna take a mile. Are you sympathetic to that?
Absolutely, I'm very sympathetic to that. I know when we started the onset of solar development here, I had people complain to me, you guys are putting solar throughout the whole valley. I said, no, just a limited amount of land. Maximum 25,000 acres. The quality of soil here is not as good as, let's say, Eastern Imperial County, like Hopeville area, where they grow a lot of vegetable crops.
So basically you guys said, this is, if we're going to put solar somewhere on farmland, this is the place to do it.
Yes.
For some landowners, on some pieces of ground, solar panels are a better deal than crops. Take Ralph Strom.
In my youth, this was a commercial citrus orchard. Tried a few things out here with a couple of different varieties of fruit trees. And because the soil is very well drained, it wasn't holding the expensive organic nutrients very well.
Ralph tried to grow carrots here at the eastern edge of the Imperial Valley. Didn't work out so well, so he struck a deal with a solar developer. I guess I'm curious what you make of that and what you see solar's role being as someone who's made this deal here.
We're understanding how finite the Colorado River is, and it's even at a critical stage now, so it's to other people's benefit also to see a project like this go forward, because it's going to put water back into the Imperial Irrigation District for other farmers.
One way or another, the Imperial Valley is going to need to use less water, but nobody can agree on the best way to do that. We're at a solar plant here on the north end of the Imperial Valley by the city of Calipat, and right on the other side of this thing by the state prison, you got the biggest solar developer around here, 8 Minute Energy, is making plans to turn some more farmland into a solar project. And on the one hand, the landowner, he said he's going to make more money doing that than he would have with farming. And on the other hand, you got a lot of the big growers out here whose agriculture is their way of life. They see solar as a threat to that. It's a tough thing because we might need all these renewables, but it's also got to work for places like this. John Hawk is one of the most outspoken critics of the solar industry in the Imperial Valley. He ran for county supervisor on an anti-solar platform against Ray Castillo. He won.
I believe that the solar people came in and they sold us a bill of goods. What has it done? Except displace over, you know, 600 to 700, 800 jobs. And they're claiming that when they built it, they created 1,500 jobs. Well, yeah, it was. They did. They created 1,500 jobs for 6 months. So those jobs are gone forever. The water is gone. If you look at the law of the river, you look at, you know, who has the priorities and when that first in use, that type of thing. So we're way at the top of the list and first in use.
The Imperial Valley has some of the oldest water rights on the Colorado River going back more than 100 years. That means in a drought, in theory, they should be the last ones cut off after Las Vegas, after Phoenix, even after Los Angeles.
You also have to go back to the agreements and say, this is what was agreed to. Stick to what was written.
That all makes sense to me about following the law, but I mean, this is easy for me to say coming from Los Angeles, but it doesn't seem super realistic politically to think that you're going to dry up Phoenix and LA before the Imperial Valley loses a drop of water.
Well, no, we're going to have to take our cuts.
Yeah.
But the other issue is then, do we dry up the Salton Sea? So you dry up the Salton Sea, the wind blows, and here comes all this dust. What do you do with that? So now we've created another problem.
Hawk is talking about the Salton Sea. The less water that's used to irrigate fields in the Imperial Valley, the less water flows into the sea. The sea is already shrinking, and it's an environmental disaster in slow motion.
Now, this is a former boat dock. This is a county park. As you can see now, there's something missing, which is water.
The water's all the way way out there.
We have some really massive dust storms that I've come out to on occasion here on super windy days to really experience it, and it's almost whiteout conditions. That blowing throughout the Imperial Valley, we have some really high asthma hospitalization rates. And this is just a fraction of what the future is at this point. Under the current projections, the Salton Sea is going to be a shadow of its former self, and there's going to be dozens of miles of exposed playa blowing dust into the air.
The sea has also been an important stopover for migratory birds heading south. More than 400 bird species have historically stopped here.
2/3 of the bird population is gone at this point, or no longer returning. When water is not being used on that farmland, it turns into solar. No water ends up in the Salton Sea. And when that water is not entering the Salton Sea accelerates its decline.
You can see right here how dry and cracked it is and deadened, really. I mean, where the water used to be and how far out it is now. And yet at the same time, big old colony of birds over there that keeps flocking up. And you know, it's not what it used to be and it's not what it should be, but it's still one of the only big sources of water out here in the desert. I mean, it's stark, but it's, I think it's pretty beautiful still. Solar power is not the only renewable resource available in Imperial County. There's also a very powerful geothermal reservoir deep beneath the southern end of the Salton Sea.
The geothermal reservoirs are where Mother Earth put them, and so we're out here.
Why is this type of energy particularly valuable for California? I mean, what makes it different than solar or wind?
Yeah, so first of all, it's renewable, so it's nice and clean. And then on top of that, just to differentiate between solar or wind is, this produces maximum output 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. 99% of the people that we'll hire to run these plants, they'll live right here in Imperial County. The California grid really needs a diverse portfolio of sources of energy. Solar's great because it's much less expensive, but it only works part of the day. Wind is less expensive, but it only works when the wind blows. So if you create your portfolio of energy sources that's nice and well-balanced, then I think the state of California wins, well, wins big.
There is nowhere in the American West quite like the Imperial Valley. It's a special place, and it could help California build a safer, more sustainable future. But that future has got to work for the people who actually live there. It's all about finding middle ground. It's not easy, but it's the only way. Thanks for watching the second episode of Repowering the West. Go back and rewatch the first episode about America's biggest wind farm. And definitely keep following us here on YouTube and at latimes.com as we keep reporting this series. Thank you.